How many have your Bibles with you this evening? We're going to be reading out of the book of Colossians of the New Testament, out of chapter 1, starting in verse 27. But I'm going to speak tonight on this second part of our series, Taking Off the Shackles of Legalism. And then we're going to really kind of dive in and talk about religion versus relationship. In fact, I want everyone to say this with me, religion or relationship. I don't have time to unpack all of this tonight, so we're going to do a part two on this next Wednesday, if the Lord will allow, because I want to help you to understand how you can walk in the fulfillment of the finished work of Jesus Christ. And so we're going to minister tonight on this thought out of Colossians chapter 1, and Paul is writing here, and he says to us in verse 27 and verse 28, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Where is Christ? He's in you. And what does he become? The hope of glory. Now, do you remember when the scriptures talk about hope, where Abraham in Hebrews chapter 11, against hope, believed in hope, that he might become? So before Jesus came on the scene, he against hope believed in hope that he might become. Hope is a very, very strong thing to have. And Paul said, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. He didn't say the Jews, he said the Gentiles. Now you have to understand something, that when he said the Gentiles, he was including you. Tell somebody, I'm included. He included us, and then he says that this is a mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. I want you to understand that that word perfect there doesn't mean that you're going to reach a place of utopia or a place of total perfection, in the sense that you'll never have a bad day, you'll never say anything wrong, you'll never possibly have an infraction in your life. That word perfect literally is talking about maturity. So I want everyone to say, I'm growing up and I'm going to be mature. Let's lift our hands and thank him. Father, we ask tonight that you would just strengthen us, encourage us, help us to run on for you. Help us to understand that you want us to have relationship and not be bogged down with religion. Help us, Lord, to be about your business and to be adamant, studious, and on point, even when we try to dissect the mystery of Christ Jesus in us. And we'll give you glory, we'll give you honor, and we'll give you praise. And everybody say, amen and amen. I want you to look at these passages of scripture, because the mystery of the ages that we read here in Colossians 1, verse 27 and through 28, is that Christ is in me. He is the hope of glory. Not Christ in the church building, not Christ up in the sky, not Christ as some specific denomination, but Christ in me and Christ in you. This is what he said that we were to have, Christ in us, and he would become our hope of glory. So here's a question that I am asked frequently, and maybe you are as well. What religion are you? And you know, when people ask me that when I was a young person, because I didn't understand what Pentecost was entirely, and I thought, I really was afraid to tell some people in my school friends that we were of Pentecostal experience, because I've learned since then that you're not Pentecost because you go to a spirit-filled, full gospel church. You're Pentecost by experience, that you have received the infilling of the Holy Ghost. And so I was somewhat afraid to tell my friends at school, because their idea was of people rolling in the floor and people swinging from chandeliers and all that kind of stuff. And so when they'd asked me that question, I just kind of mumble under my breath because I didn't know exactly how to answer them. But it wasn't until I come on into Jesus and begin to mature in the Lord that I understand that it's not about religion and it's not about denomination. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ. So I don't like to be asked the question, what religion are you? Because my response when I'm asked is, I'm not religious. I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, religion is a set of rules and a set of regulations and a set of beliefs that we have to follow if we're going to be part of an organization or a particular group. And each one that I've encountered along the way have their own set of rules and their own bylaws and their own conducts and their own ideologies of what you have to do to make it to heaven. And there are so many rules that people have. May I tell you that some churches make it harder for you to join their church than it is to get into heaven. So a religion literally is man's idea of God's expectations. And you know, you can write it down if you want to, but I want you to catch that. Religion is man's idea of God's expectations. So in order for you to understand God's expectations, you'd have to have a revelation of Jesus and a revelation in your spirit to know who he is and what he wants you to do. Now, sometimes we put expectations on ourselves that have no basis in God's word. We are sometimes guilty of putting our own expectations on other people and expecting them to do it our way and expecting people to line up with our thinking and our theology and our philosophy. So we put our expectations on people instead of helping people be what God wants them to be. Let me give you a few examples if I can tonight. Maybe a person is called and they're anointed as an intercessor, and then they make the mistake of judging everyone's prayer life by their prayer life. They think, if you're going to be an intercessor, you got to pray like me. You got to do what I do. Or maybe a teacher of God's word would expect everyone to study as much as they do. And if you don't study like they do, then you're just not in alignment and you're not conforming to our religion. Now, can I tell you that doctrines vary? Doctrines vary. Is it important for our church or a church to make known its doctrine? Absolutely. It's important for us not only to make it known, but so that the Bible says, how can two walk together lest they be in agreement? And so our doctrinal statement or commitment to the Word of God backed by the Scripture is available on our website. It's available for anybody to see. But doctrines vary in the world we live in. Some say in the various of doctrines, hold on to your seat, some say that sprinkling is the way to baptize. And others say we must be immersed. Some baptize babies, and the parents promise to raise them as a believer of Jesus Christ. But others say you must have accepted Jesus personally and be baptized after that. And they dedicate babies and baptize them later. Some baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And others baptize in Jesus' name only. And so I'm trying to get you to understand that doctrines vary. Are you here? Some people believe in all of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to Paul's writing in 1 Corinthians 12. But others believe that the spirit gifts disappeared in the early church. Some believe in speaking in other tongues, and some believe that speaking in tongues is of the devil. Some believe a Christian can have a demon, and others say, no way. Some believe in casting out devils, healing the sick, and some don't. Some believe that God can use women, and some don't. Oh, I got some of you on board on that one. I'm just trying to get you to understand the difference. Some believe that God wants us to prosper, and other people believe that God is not interested in our finances. He's only interested in our spirits. Now, let me give you scripture. In 3 John chapter 2, or 3 John verse 2. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Some say, if God wants me to have that, what about him just giving it to me? If he wants me to have it, he'll just give it to me. But James chapter 4 verse 2 said, you have not because you ask not. So the result of all the division and all the confusion in doctrinal differences causes us to be powerless. We are not as powerful as we could be. Religion does not give you power, but a deep personal relationship with the Holy Spirit, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, gives you power, even according to Paul's writing in 1 Corinthians 12, where he said the Holy Spirit would give us the spirit gifts, that Jesus would give us the administrative gifts, and that God would give us the operational gifts. And it's all found in 1 Corinthians 12. But let me throw another scripture. Philippians 3 and 10 says that I might know him in the power of his resurrection. So I'm talking to you about not having religion, but having a what? A relationship. Because a relationship brings me into the power and the fullness of God. May I tell you that I was religious for years and never even heard that I could enjoy the power of God in my life. I grew up in a church that we had Holy Ghost meetings and the power of God would move, and not once a month there'd be a real teardown. We'd have such a meeting that people would be running and screaming and crying, and I mean a powerful move of God. And then we didn't know how to appropriate that. We didn't know. We just thought God showed up like a stick of dynamite once a month. And so we'd have an explosive service on a Sunday night, but we'd live like the devil Monday through Friday because we did not know how to flow in that same experience that happened on Sunday night. We'd be defeated. Can I get a witness from somebody? Because God is not just a God of dynamite. He's a God of dynamo. And dynamo, according to the word dunamis, the Greek word in the New Testament, I will give you power, dunamis, is an inherent power that is capable of reproducing itself over and over and over again. That's why the scripture said, when you lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. And by the time you have laid hands on one person, before you lay hands on another, inherent power will reproduce itself yet again, and you'll have the power of God to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. So growing up, I didn't necessarily understand that. I learned that he was powerful, but I was never taught that through him, I could move and have my being. Through him, I could also be powerful Monday through Friday on the daily. That I could go to work and be powerful. That I could work in the garden and be powerful. And I learned that God wants me to operate in his power. Punch your neighbor on the shoulder and say, get you some power. Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 5 that there are many people who have a form of godliness, but what do? They deny the power thereof. What did he say to do to them?
turn away from. They look the part, but they have no power. Mm-hmm. Jesus taught us in Matthew chapter 12, verse 25 through 30, and I'm going to throw scripture at you. You're just going to have to write whatever comes up on the screen or what you hear me say. That a kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. Jesus believed in casting out demons, but the Pharisees said he was a devil. A religious person cannot stand to see someone do or know something that they don't know or cannot do. A religious person is not one bit excited when somebody who just flows in the gifts of God begins to operate in the power of God. The reason? Because they didn't do it the way they said it should be done. In Mark 16 and verse 17, the scripture said that these signs shall follow them that what? Believe. And he said, in my name they shall cast out devils and speak with new tongues. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 23 through 24, Jesus has a conversation with these religious folks known as the Pharisees. And I want to say this tonight. The reason they were, we could put a spin on their name and say that the reason they're Pharisees is because they're not fair, you see? Woe, he says, unto you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you paid tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye have done, and not to leave the other undone. You blind guides, which strain at a gnat, but you'll swallow a camel. Jesus was being real direct with these religious folks. May I tell you that proper doctrine is important, but an organization that just teaches doctrine and never gets around to teaching you about the practical side of Christianity is only going to produce frustrated Christians. Hear me. People who only know the rules. They don't have the power to follow the rules, but they know the rules. People who have all kinds of head knowledge, but no victory in their own life. They can tell you what to do, but they themselves cannot do it in their own power. Religions often make up their own rules. And if there's something they personally don't like, they make a rule to keep it out of their organization, out of their church, out of whatever. And if there's something that they've not experienced, then they believe it cannot be right for anyone. May I tell you that my mother and father were raised of a certain denominational belief, and they were taught not to associate, get hooked up with them Pentecostal people. Sometimes what we've never experienced for ourselves, we write off and try to tell everyone else you should have nothing to do with it. But here's what I know. Jesus said, taste and see that he is good. And when you experience the love of God, there can nobody talk you out of the power and the presence of Almighty God. How many in this room know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he washed you clean, that he removed your sin as far as the east is from the west, never to be remembered against you? Can nobody talk you out of that? Now listen, God gave Moses 10 commandments, and by the time Jesus came, the Pharisees, religious leaders, had turned them into 2,200 rules for the people to follow. God gave Moses 10, but by Jesus' coming, they had already added 2,010 or 2,180 or 190 in addition to the 10. Now think of this. Religion is usually about what I can do, not what Jesus has done. It says, here are the rules. If you follow them, you'll be all right. Here are the rules. If you do this, don't do that, you'll make it in. But Jesus taught us in Luke 18, 9 through 14, that it is that religion or our works can never justify us. We are justified by faith in through Jesus Christ and the grace of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. May I tell you that Christ's work on the cross and his resurrection justifies us. His blood justifies us. It makes us right with God. Not my ability, not by sticking to the rules, but the blood of Jesus and the word of God. That's what frees me and allows me to live, not by works that I can boast in, but by grace through faith in Jesus, through the shed blood of the Lord. Somebody ought to shout amen if you've come through that blood. In Romans chapter 3 and verse 20, Paul said, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in the spirit. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. The law cannot redeem me. The law cannot justify me. Jesus went on to say in Matthew 7, verse 21 through 23, that many will say, Lord, Lord, we did this in your name, we did that in your name. And the Bible said he's going to respond and say, depart from me, I never knew you. You had religion, but you had no relationship. Come on, church. He wants us to know that that doesn't mean we just have a casual acquaintance with him. Oh, I did this in your name. It means that we know him and that he knows us. There is a difference between knowing and knowing. May I tell you that Beverly knows me. Caitlin knows me. I know them. There's a difference about knowing about God and knowing God. Can you say amen? Write this down. What about the law, the commandments of God, and all those rules? What do we do with that? Aren't we supposed to follow the rules? Aren't we supposed to follow the law? Hold on. Yes, we are. We're to follow God's commands and his law. But we can only do so through a deep personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, I've got to give you scripture. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 through 13 says that it instructs us to live a holy life, but we cannot do it in our own strength. For it is God who is at work in us, giving us the will and the desire to do right. He has to give me the will. He has to give me the desire to do right. Because I've tried it, and I cannot do it without him. I've had people tell me, Pastor, I tried to live for God. It did not work. So I went back to my old ways. And the reason that they failed at it, so to speak, is because they didn't let God do the living in them. He has to do the living in you so that you can live through the power of that relationship, not in your own works, come on, not in our own thoughts, not in our own process. He has to do the living in me. In Romans chapter 5 and verse 20, the Bible said, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace doth much more abound. Where the law had to come in, so that the offense might abound. But where is sin abounded, grace did much more abound. He's saying in this passage in Romans 5 that the law came in to expand and increase the trespass, in making it to you and I apparent and to be something that it was in opposition of our inward being. But where sin increased, abounded grace. Wherever sin was, God's grace came in on the double. God's grace came in on the triple. God's grace came in on the quadruple. In other words, he increased the grace wherever there was a measure of sin. And the grace of God was God's unmerited favor that was given to you and I. And it has surpassed it and has increased it and it has superabounded it. Because God wants you to know that wherever sin is, grace does much more abound. What the law could do was point me to my sin and point me to my failure. But what it demanded, nothing could supply until Jesus came and gave grace. And what the law demanded, Jesus supplied. And he did it in abundance. Whoo! Your sins have been covered. So God gave the law so we could see what it would take to be holy. And that's vital when you're going to enter into the presence of God and start having fellowship with God. We have to be made right, righteous. We have to be made right with God. He is holy, and if he's holy, we need to be holy to enjoy a right relationship. And nothing else is acceptable. The law is holy because God gave it, but man cannot keep it. If he's guilty in one point, he's guilty in all. If you can't keep all 613 Mosaic laws, or the laws that were given and added to, which total 613, if you can't keep one of them, the Bible says you've broken all of them. Are you understanding? And so the law pointed me to the holiness of God, but as a human, I could not keep it in the frailty of my flesh. I needed a spirit. I needed Jesus from another world to enter into my body, to enter into my soul, and to resurrect my spirit so that I could have right relationship with God. Not a keeper of religion, but a keeper of relationship. God, through his spirit, helps me to identify the holiness of him and live a holy life unto God. And my God, we need to go back to holy living and holiness. And the Bible said, without holiness, no man will see the Lord. We've got to become a holy people. Are you here? In 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21, the scripture said, for he hath made him, Jesus, to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Let me give you a definition of holiness. The definition of holiness is literally sanctification, the setting apart of your life. Holiness is a state that is predetermined by God for every believer into which grace calls me into. The grace of God calls me into a life of holiness, sanctification, separation, righteousness unto God. He calls me by his spirit and grace into that, and that's where I begin my Christian course and I begin to pursue it. That's why today we call one another the saints of God. We are considered to be a child of God, or the saints, come on, because we are learning to walk in the holiness and the purity of God. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9, that sainthood is not some attainment. It's a state to which God calls grace, or calls men by grace unto him. And that the Bible said, who has saved us and has called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. When did we get it? Before the world, we were called before the world began, that he was trying to call us into a holy relationship with him and have deep interpersonal relationship with his people. Can I tell you, how could I be a singer if I don't have a singer inside of me? I could take lessons. I could get a song. I could sing it, but nobody would recognize me as a singer. However, if God has placed a gift of being a singer in me, then I can develop the gift and become a singer in the natural realm. Here's what I'm telling you. In Romans 11, verse 16, it says, if the root is holy, then the branches are holy too. So if God has put something in me that he's going to call out of me and call me into, when he called me to be sanctified and called me to be holy, it's already in me. And so the root of God is in me, and therefore I am the branch of God, and I am holy as well. He has already put holiness in me. He's already put a conscience in me. He's already put a desire in me that cannot be lived by law. It has to be obtained through a personal God relationship. Is there anybody in this room that is so thankful that the moment you gave your heart and life to Jesus, something on the inside of you woke up? The root is holy and the branches are as well. We are made something in the spirit realm by God, and it is then manifested in the natural realm by our cooperation with the Holy Spirit to develop the gift God has already placed in us. Now, I've got to give you more. In Galatians 3 and verse 10, if a person believes they will be holy by following a certain prescribed guideline for their behavior, the Bible says in the end they're going to be very disappointed. Here's a scripture that people quote but don't know the meaning of. Look at this. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone, hashtag. Cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. Some would say, well, that means that you've got to keep the law or you're going to be cursed. But that's not what Paul was saying. He's saying if you believe that you're going to be holy by following a prescribed set of rules for behavior, you are going to end up very, very disappointed. And that's the definition and the understanding of coming under that curse. So I want you to understand very clearly that the root of the struggle we experience in our lives. Many of us have thought, I have to keep this rule. I have to do this, or God's not going to be satisfied with me. God's not going to be pleased with me. But that's the religious thinking. That is the rules keeping. That's the lines that you better not color out of the line. You better stay right there. The root of the struggle is in it, we experience it in our own life because some things that we've been taught. If I have accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, and I have been now made through that relationship right with God, righteousness with God, and I have been made holy because the holiness of God through that relationship has now been imputed into me. And if I continue in an unholy lifestyle, I cannot possibly be anything but miserable because I'm not being what I am to be. He has already imputed to me holiness. He has given me the righteousness. And if I don't live according to the holiness of God, I don't need a rule over here to tell me that. Jesus inside me will tell me that. And I will be a miserable person to live with because I have sin in my life. Come on. That's why the heathen is not bothered by his sin. But a born-again believer is miserable when they sin. Because you have had imputed into you the holiness of God. If I'm a religious person who works hard to follow the rules and all the regulations, but I am really not born again, I don't have Christ living in me. I'll always feel frustrated because no matter what I try to do, I can never quite measure up. I've not had a relationship with God. And therefore, I'm trying to follow rules and regulations, but they don't bring me hope and they don't bring me joy because Christ in me is my hope of glory. I can go to church all my life and serve in the church and hold a position and not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I must know who I am in Christ before I can ever hope to do what he wants me to do in Christ. I have to know who I am. Elbow somebody and say, I know who I is. So the strength of the law must begin on the inside and work its way to the outside. He does a work in me so he can do a work through me. Jesus on the inside, work it on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. Christ in me becomes my hope of glory. In Ephesians 6 and 10, Paul said, finally, my brethren, finally, I've read all these chapters in this book and reached the last part. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. He is talking about being strong and in power in the relational union that God has called you to. When you walk in the relationship of God, you enter into power you didn't know you had. When you're in union with the Creator, he is in union with you. He said that we can have fellowship one with another. We can walk in the power of God because he lives on the inside of us. And you see, if you don't have Jesus on the inside of you, you're an empty shell. You walk in with rules and religious and religiosity, but you don't have a personal relationship to empower you to live in holiness and to live in the Spirit of God. Can I ask you a question? How can Beverly and I enter properly into a union of marriage and become one unless we have a rich life of fellowship one with another? When we have fellowship one with another, we have the power of that relationship in operation in our life. Well, hallelujah. So when Jesus is in your life, it don't matter where you are, the power of God is resident in you. If you're in Indianapolis or a foreign field, the same power in that union is with you wherever you go. Write this down. Religion without relationship will produce hypocrites. Now, Jesus said, in Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 through 28, and we don't have time to read all that. But one thing he said was, woe to you scribes and Pharisees and you pretenders, hypocrites. I've had people say, Pastor, I won't go to that church because there's a bunch of hypocrites in there. And I want to say, well, one more won't hurt. When did you become so high and mighty? Jesus said, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, and you pretenders. You see, people become confused when it comes to religion, but no relationship. They go to church, but they're always ready to sue someone. Let me preach in here. They'll come to church, and when the pastor goes to preach, they leave the sanctuary and hide. Conviction. There's something wrong with a person's spirit when they get up and keep running out. Are you understanding me? They go to church, but all they have is a form, but not an inward power. Now listen, people who keep the rules, they're there every time the doors are open, but they'll drop at the drop of a hat, will sue the britches off somebody. They want to live for God. But I've met people who want to live for God, but they've been raised to believe that they'll never make it to heaven unless they pay some kind of penance for their sin. They think they have to pay penance to get to heaven. There are people that suffer all their life financially, but think it's displeasing to God for them to ask God for financial help. They have been believing this rule or this way of thinking. And I want you to know that anyone, hear me, anyone you have a true relationship with wants to bless you. Anyone you have a true relationship with wants to bless you. Can you say amen? So what makes us sincere instead of being a pretender? Listen, doing something because we genuinely want to, not just to impress someone. That makes you sincere. If we pray to get brownie points with God, then we're being a pretender and a hypocrite. How many people have said on their hospital bed, "Oh, Pastor, pray with me. If God will raise me up from this, I promise I'll be in church. I promise I'll treat my wife right. I promise I'll treat my husband right. If God will raise me and pull me out, if he'll save me down at the court hearing, I promise," come on somebody, "I promise you that I'll live for the Lord." And what happens is they're only making a promise with no power behind it, because there is no personal relationship. They may come for a few weeks. They may come for a few months after the funeral. But without a personal relationship with Jesus, they're scattered. And people are trying to do right. They're trying to stay out of trouble with God. And there's a lot of people. And they do that. They come to church for that very reason. But if you love God, you want to do it. You want to be in his house. You want to be where believers are. You want to be sharpened. You want the power of God that comes through koinonia, the fellowship of the saints together. See, some people are just doing right because they have to. But when you want to, it's a whole new way of living. And you are then positioning yourself in right relationship with God for him to pour his power upon your life. When I have a relationship with Jesus, I don't have to have a list of rules of what you cannot do and what you cannot do. Well, I hear the scripture in Ezekiel 36 that says that God would give us a new heart and then he would write his law in our heart. I wouldn't have to refer to some manuscript or some transcript, and I wouldn't have to make it back into the ancient archives. I could live according to the precepts of God's word, because with his own hand, he wrote his law. He wrote his word down in my heart. He gave me a new heart and wrote his word in it. So that's how I live, by the Spirit, not by the law. Are you here? He gives us a new want to, a new heart. Paul said in Romans 7, Paul describes the war between the new nature and the old nature. Do you remember when he said things like, "The thing that I wouldn't do, I end up doing"? Anybody remember that? "Things I don't want to do, I find myself doing"? New nature, old nature. New nature, old nature. And he tells us the only way that we can do what is right is just trust Jesus. He went on to say in 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 9 that we are called into fellowship with Jesus Christ our Lord. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. I am called to fellowship with God. I'm not called to struggle to keep the law. Come on, church. God has already given me a desire to do right, because I'm in relationship with him. And I got a new heart. And he wrote his word in my heart. So I have a new desire in me to do what's right. And my fellowship with him enables me to do it. In 1 John 1 and 3, our fellowship is with the Father and with Christ Jesus, according to the word. Look at this. "That which you have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." In John 16 and 7, the scripture said that Jesus said he would send the Holy Spirit to be close fellowship with us. Look what he says. "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away, for if I don't go away, the Comforter will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you." Why? Because there is no way that we can learn what we need to do without that intimate fellowship and relationship with God. He teaches me. He instructs me. Now, write this down, and I'm almost done. Religion is a heavy burden. Oh, it's heavy. Donnie Marie Osmond said, "He ain't heavy. He's our brother." Do you remember that? Some of you are like, who's Donnie Marie? 70s speaking here. They had a brother who was a little slow, and the whole family had to look after him. And they said, he's not heavy. In other words, he's not a burden. He's our brother. Let me tell you something about religion. Religion is a burden to carry around with you. Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 23, verse 34 through 40, that they wanted to discuss heavy doctrine. Oh, they wanted to. The Sadducees and the Pharisees came together, and they came together asking him questions, trying to tempt Jesus. Master, they said, what's the greatest commandment of the law? Trying to trap him. Of the law. And Jesus said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And this is the first and the great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And then Jesus closes it by saying, on these two commandments hang the law and the prophets. Everything hinges on love God first, love other people second. They were trying to trap Jesus into getting him to tell them which was the greatest law. Do you know that many religious people are very prideful? They're judgmental. They're self-righteous. And most of them that I meet are very sour in the face. They have a gloom of heaviness about them. And you can see it on their faces. And the reason I'm telling you this is because they don't get to enjoy life because they're usually angry at whoever is enjoying life. Come on. In John 10 and 10, Jesus said you could have life and have it abundantly, fully. In John 9, verses 1 through 25, it shows us how complicated the religious people can get. I can't read all of this, but on this occasion, Jesus heals a blind man on the Sabbath day. And they get all up in arms at Jesus. Up. You can't do that. You can't do that on the Sabbath day. Many people do not even try to understand things concerning the kingdom of God because they are presented in a way that makes them sound confusing. And sometimes when we don't understand something, we just kind of like scratch our head and look at it and say, I don't know. But deep things need to be unearthed. You need to know the why. They were so upset because Jesus healed this man on the Sabbath day and opened his blinded eyes. They got so upset, they started shotgun firing questions at Jesus. Who sinned? His mother? His father? How could you heal this man on the Sabbath day? And they questioned the man, what happened to you? And I love the response. I don't know what happened to me. All I know is I was blind, but now I can see. You may have thought it was the wrong day, but Jesus flipped the script and said, I am the Sabbath. I am the rest. Come unto me, all of you who are heavy laden, you shall find rest for your soul. A relationship with Jesus relieves the burden. It don't give you a burden. I got to carry this around. I got a relationship with Jesus. Look how much fun I'm having. I got 613 laws and all the dietary customs to meet. I got to get to heaven. Jesus said in Matthew 11:30 that my yoke is easy and my burden is poof, be gone. That's how light it is. His burden is light, easy to bear, not harsh, not sharp, not pressing, easy. In Isaiah 61 and 3, aren't you glad we're going to the Word for this? He gives us the garment of praise in exchange for the spirit of heaviness, the burden, the falling apart. I get the garment of praise. In Exodus 1:11, Pharaoh put burdens on the people to keep them from becoming powerful. Satan fears the power of the Holy Spirit in you, and he does not want you to be filled with that power. Write this down in 1 Timothy 6 and 3. Read this with me. Religious people want to argue about words and doctrinal phrases. The Bible says, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to the wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the doctrine which is according to godliness, here's what he is. He is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words. Wherefore, out of that comes envy, strife, railings, and evil surmisings. Perverse disputings among men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth. Supposing that gain is godliness, he said, when you encounter them, withdraw yourself. Easy peasy. That's what he said. People want to catch you up in phrases and half-truths and split things. Don't split hairs with them. Withdraw yourself. That's what the scripture says. You don't have time to do that and have relationship with Christ. He's trying to move you into power, not keep you bound. Somebody say amen. A religious spirit exalts itself above the Spirit of Christ. Religious people want to know about how much education I have, what my degrees in theology are. They don't care about my fruit. They don't count changed lives and families. They just want degrees. They just want to know, what's this mean? Do you have this? A self-righteous religious spirit will produce guilt and condemnation, and it will always place blame on folks. Guilt to condemn, pressed down, heavily weighed upon. In Matthew 11 through 16 and 19, the Bible says we cannot please the system because we'll always fail. Therefore, because we're trying to please the system, we are always found guilty of the system. In Matthew 12, verse 1 through 15, the Pharisees are always watching to find something to accuse us about. Listen to me, church. Jesus said he was Lord of the Sabbath. In other words, God gave the rules concerning the Sabbath, but he's the boss. And the boss can override his own rules if the need arises. Oh, somebody said, he doesn't change, because the scripture said that he's God and he changeth not. Well, that's not talking about the mind of God. The person of God doesn't change, but can God change his mind? Sure he can. When Saul went another route, he said, it repents me that I ever made him a king. When Moses pleaded for God, please don't wipe these people out. I know all they do is gossip and murmur and complain in the church nursery. Please don't wipe them out. God changed his mind. Can he change his mind? He's the boss. Are you understanding? We have a rule here in our house for those that work in this house. Everybody is here by starting time. And that means you get here early enough to get all your personal things done, put your lunch in the refrigerator, go to the bathroom, say hello to everybody, get your coffee, call your kids and talk to them about their soccer practice after church, after work, and that's the rule. We start at this time. Are you here? However, if I give someone permission to be late for a specific reason, my current decision overrides my previous one as far as they're concerned. Did you hear me? Jesus wants us to show mercy and help people, but the religious leaders wanted to accuse people and wanted to condemn people because they weren't doing it the way they thought they should. In Luke chapter 11, verse 46, the Bible said that the Pharisees handed out heavy burdens, but were not willing to help anybody. How do I know? Because he said, "Woe unto you also, you lawyers. You have laid grievous burdens that cannot be borne, but you yourself cannot even bear one with your own finger. But you're trying to put all this heavy stuff on people." Let me give you an example in the New Testament church. Sometimes the way I was raised, and I witnessed this, someone would come in to the church for a service, a prostitute even, dressed very scantily, come to the altar, and sometimes before they ever left the building, some religious person would go up to them and say something like this: "Now, before you come back on Sunday, you better change the way you look." I've seen it. Put grievous burdens on people which we ourselves can't even bear with one finger. But we expect everybody else to tote the note. Look at your neighbor and say, "Lucille, he's talking to us." Trying to put stuff on people. See, I don't say much. You don't hear me preach a lot about clothesline. I believe the Holy Spirit will teach you. He will. You don't hear me preach a lot about, well, I'm going to get in trouble, people who shack up and aren't married, but they want the benefits of being married. Come on. I just believe when he gives you revelation, you'll run to him because the holiness of God has been imputed into you. And if you're not in right standing with him, I won't make you miserable. You'll be miserable on your own. Smile at me. And I can't tell you how many couples in the past few years who came to this house who might have been living together, over the course of time, we didn't shun nobody. We'll preach down to people. We're trying to get people across the finish line. But we don't clean a fish until it's caught. The Holy Spirit will do the cleaning. Keep your mouth off of people. Keep your fingers from off pointing at people. For what judgment you judge, you shall be judged of the same thing. Let God do it. And when he does it, it's by revelation and relationship. The Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 27, true religion is always occupied by helping other people. So is there a difference between religion and relationship? Yeah. Scripture says this: pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep ourselves unspotted from the world. That's true religion. I want you to understand that God wants you to have relationship, fellowship, because from that comes power to live in union with him, equipping and enabling, a spring in your step, and joy. Next week, if the Lord will allow, I'll talk to you about pride and religious spirits being bed partners. I want to tell you something. God wants you to take the shackles off of legalism. I'm not talking about just living any old way you want to, because when you have a relationship with Jesus, you'll want to do as much as you can for him. I have a relationship with this lady on the front row, my wife. We've been married 25 years. And listen to this. We didn't just get there overnight. There were times we fought or battled it out. We fought on who was going to be in charge. Can I preach to anybody in the room? We took the word divorce out of our vocabulary. It has probably kept us. Because I don't care how saved you are, you still live here. Marriages may be made in heaven, but they have to be lived here on earth. And a lot of times you just got to learn how to get rid of your pride, because we don't want to bow down. We are stubborn people. I'm telling you, I'm looking in the eyes of some stubborn folks. Well, that's not very nice. We got an altar. We'll take care of it in a minute. Everybody in this room, those watching, are stubborn at times. Very stubborn. Listen to me. But what happens is when you enter into that relationship, you learn how to love each other in unconditional love. And in that love produces power. Power. Oh, two are better than one. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When I cannot pray for myself, my wife can pray for me and bring strength to me. When she can't pray for herself, I can lay hands on her and pray for her. Are you hearing me? Two are better than one. That relationship has taken time to forge, time to blossom, time for us to work out all of our issues so we can enter into a holy right standing with God. Because if you are at odds with your spouse, the Bible says your prayers are hindered. Oh, that helps somebody. If you're at odds with your pastor, your prayers are hindered. If I'm at odds with you, my prayers are hindered. We have to have relationship to form union, and then we get to experience power that comes from that. Isn't that exciting? Do you have religion, or do you have relationship? I don't have time to unpack the rest of it. We'll talk more about the law and legalism next week. But I'm talking about, do you have and know the difference between religion? When somebody asks you, what's your religion? What are you going to say? I'm not religious. I have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Would you stand to your feet if you have a relationship with Christ? And if you're on a journey to find that relationship, stand to your feet with us. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed for a moment. God doesn't want you to live under the condemnation of not keeping the rules. He has given you a new heart and has wrote his word in your heart. And you don't have to, you will want to. Nobody had to tell me to stop drinking. I don't want to drink. Nobody had to tell me to stop smoking. I don't want to smoke. Don't get mad at me. I'm trying to, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You can't even see me. Nobody had to tell me to stop doing this or that. The Holy Spirit will teach me, because there will be a, don't do that in my spirit, because he has put a holy unction in me. He has invested holiness in me. It was imputed unto me. Righteousness was invested in me, which means I don't want to sin. If I sin, I have a Father who loves me so much that he'll forgive me. I can confess my sins. I can repent. And the Bible said that he is so faithful. He is so just. Oh, I love that about God. He don't show favoritism. He just loves me. I don't have to compete with nobody. He's faithful. He's just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. He puts me back in relationship with him when I come to him. And I cry out to him. He then imputes to me, invests in me, deposits into me his holiness. He teaches me how to walk. He teaches me how to live. Every day is a new chapter. He's showing me how to have relationship with him. It's so easy to have a relationship with Jesus today. The Bible said that even a child could enter in. That's the simplicity of the gospel. And I'm telling you, church, and I want you to hear me, anybody who's trying to tell you you've got to keep this rule and that law, all 613 laws that are mentioned in the Old Testament, the 2,200 that were added to the 10 by the time Jesus came by the Pharisees, laws, they're trying to tell you you have to do this and that. That's not relationship. That's you've got to keep a law. And it's so heavy to carry. And it's so burdensome that you'll stumble with it, you'll fall out of it, and you'll say, I couldn't do it. But a relationship with Jesus is a fulfillment of his word in you. When Jesus pronounced on the cross, it is finished. He was saying to you, I've closed the door behind you. Now walk forward in my finished work. I will become your rest. I will become your grace. I will keep you from sin. You will live in relationship with me, and you'll walk in freedom. And it's not about the rules now. It's about the relationship, because my heart, my nature is changed, and I want to live for God, and it's easy to live for God. It's not a struggle to live for God. I'm not saying I don't have issues or problems or things I got to overcome, but I have such a relationship with God that he will help me overcome them, and he won't make me feel guilty. If I sin, I can come to Jesus quickly, and he will forgive me when I repent. He'll forgive me quickly. He loves me. I'm trying to get the church to understand. It's not about how many laws you keep, because the laws could not do it. Paul said, when faith has come, when Jesus has come, you and I are no longer under a schoolmaster. What the law could not do, Jesus supplied and did. And then he says, because I did it, you get to enjoy it. Now just walk with me in relationship. And that's what's going to get you to heaven. That's what's going to get you across the finish line, is a relationship with Jesus. And I'm asking everyone in the room, how's your relationship with Christ? Where are you at in that? Is he your all in all? Is he your first choice? Or has he become your third or fourth? Is he your everything? The desire in you to run for Jesus will be imputed to you when you make him Lord of all. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You're here today and you say, Pastor, I want to confirm and affirm my relationship with Jesus. Christ in me, the hope of glory. And if that's you, I want you to come forward tonight. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You want to affirm your relationship with Jesus. Today is a day that you're allowing God to rewrite your heart and rewrite your nature by making him Lord of your life. And when you do that, you're stepping into a new and living way according to the scripture. Are there others tonight? God is dealing with you, calling you about your relationship with him, speaking to you about your soul. I want you to come. Respond. I need some brothers to help me pray right now. The Holy Spirit is speaking to us today about our walk with him. Before we go anywhere else in this service, if we need anything else, this is the primary thing to make sure that everyone's ready to meet God. Are you ready to meet God? Have you had your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Have you entered into a love relationship with Jesus? First question you've got to ask yourself, am I where I should be? Second question, am I still walking in what he called me? Am I still doing what he said? Am I still passionate for the Lord? And if yours not maybe as passionate as you once were, I want you to respond. And I want you to come and just fill the altar with tears. Cry out to God again. Ask God to help you. Ask him to help you live. You cannot live it on your own, but you can live it with him living in you. And he'll help you. He'll help me. He'll help us. Father, we thank you for your divine enablement and your help. Going forward in faith, We ask you for your strength. You said that our strength, our weakness would become strength. That you would take even the weakness and the frailty of man and make us strong. Thank you, God, for seeing us in our frailty and loving us unconditionally. Thank you, God. Thank you for relationship. Thank you, God, for those of you that have that relationship and you feel like, man, God is still fired in me. He's still reviving me. He's helping me. I want you to start praising him right where you are. I want you to start thanking him for that relationship because it means something to you. It's so special. It's so dynamic. It's so life-changing. I want to thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you for entering into my heart. Thanking you. I thank you, God, for giving me a new desire, a new passion. Thank you, Lord, for loving me unconditionally. Help me, Jesus. Help me, Father. Father, we thank you and we praise you. We glorify your name, Lord. Thank you, God, for loving us, strengthening us, helping us. Everyone in the room, just begin to thank him. Would you do that? Begin to worship him. Holy Spirit, we invite you now. Just sweep through the house. Sweep through the house. Touch our mind. Touch us.
Your soul filled the maps. Your word moved through my hands. Your thoughts stay on my mind. Live in me. Your soul filled through my lips. Your word moved through my hands. Your thoughts stay on my mind. Live in me. You can have all.
Oh, baby.
That church.
Your work
moved in my hands, your thoughts filled my mind, live in me. Your song flowed through my lips, your work moved through my hands,
your
thoughts filled my mind,
live in me.
Your song flowed through my lips, your work, come on, wave your hand at the Lord. Want you to use me, Jesus.
Live in me.
Your song flowed through my lips. Your word flew through my hands.
Your thoughts stay on my mind.
Live in me.
You can have.
You can have all of me. Have all of me. Have all of me. I'm yours. Would you give the Lord a great big hand of praise? Thank you, Holy Spirit, for renewing relationship with us. The Lord is with us tonight, amen? Reach over and touch the neighbor on your left and your right and say, thank you for being in relationship and union with me. Thank you for loving God and loving me. I'm going to ask tonight if you'll remain standing. I want to ask Brother Peyton and Sister Kim Williams and their family if they're here. I think I see them all. Come up here on the platform if you will. I'm really excited for this family, and I'm sad, but I'm happy. Brother Peyton and Sister Kim and their family are moving back to California. Brother Peyton has accepted a position at Azusa Pacific University as the director of compliance. And these, oh, come over here, Sister Kim, get real close. Family, come on over. Peyton, get out in front so we can see you. There you go. Little Peyton. Beverly, come stand on the other side of these family, if you would. I'm telling you, we have loved this family for eight years. Wow. And you know, it wasn't long ago that Brother Peyton had kind of shared some things with me that I didn't know the timing of God, but I kind of knew that there was maybe an opportunity that they'd be moving back to California, where they're from. They're beach people, you know. They're California dream. And they have served in the house and you know, just been faithful and been part of the transformation of the house. And I remember watching God bless them. My first meal that I had with Peyton was at, I think, a one-on-one we had at City Barbecue. Yep. And he shared some of his life story with me. You never know what a person has gone through, been through, and how God has enabled them and placed a burden in their heart to live for him until you get to know each other. And that's what we were talking about tonight, that fellowship. But they've also served in our sports ministry and carried the mantle and the baton passed to them from Brother Andy Carpenter, and Peyton and Kim picked it up and didn't look back. And my, the Lord is blessed. The Lord is blessed. And I want them to say something, first of all. I'm not going to do all the talking. But they're going to say something, and I want you to, you know, hear what their heart, and they're going to be heading back to California. So at least Beverly and I will have a place to stay when we go to California. But I want you to just share your heart, Peyton and Kim, both of you.
This house has changed our lives. When we came here, it was after years of law school and doing a lot on my own, I felt like, and there was a separation here between us. And one day, I was looking for churches, we searched for a whole year, and I was looking for a different church, and it was no longer in existence, and I came here and it said, welcome home. And I pulled up, and I said, I found it. And we've been here ever since. I can say that you guys have been my sisters, my brothers, my aunts, uncles, grandmas, and grandpas, to me and my kids. Raise your hand out there if you've ever picked up one of these kids, watched them overnight. and the many, you know, there's so many of them, you know, that have watched and really helped for a family who had no family here. This church was our family. It is our family. And I just pray that if whoever comes out to California to come out, please, you have an open door and come see us, because it's your family, and you will always be that for us. Thank you.
I'll try to be quick. Sometimes folks have... Thanks. Love you too, sweetie. Thank you. I'll try to be quick. This... is something that needed to happen. Just with the things been going on with my family. I mean, we've been here since Peyton was one. So he was a lot smaller. Bree was in kindergarten and Sydney was in first grade. And now they're about to start high school. But just as they've grown older, our parents have grown older, my grandparents have grown older, and they're fighting some battles. So, I mean, if you can pray for my mother and my grandparents, it would be great. The devil's really fighting my mother a lot. And last year, I had to pick her up out of her bed and carry her to our car to get her to the hospital so she could be hospitalized. And the doctor said that getting her there saved her life. So it's something where we all need to get back to them. Grandfather's almost 90 and trying to take care of her and trying to take care of his wife, who's starting to, you know, lose her memory a little bit. And so it's a battle. And then as we're praying and trying to find a way, God brings a place and an opportunity, because I didn't know how we were going to be able to do it. And he did, and he's really brought us a long way. And in my work and what I do, and I talk to young people here, and the lessons I learn here are the things I tell them, and they go off and tell other people. We had a prayer circle for a young man whose father was dealing with open heart surgery, and we had 30 young people all over the country, Canada, South Africa, California, New York. They asked me, can we get into a prayer circle and pray? And I'm ready to lead the prayer, and somebody else starts the prayer and leads it off, and we go for 7 minutes praying for a man we've never seen, but we know a young man that we love. And it's a heart that starts here, where we say everyone, and we say together. And being in this house has been so special for our family. It's been special for us. We'll truly miss it. And it'll always be in our hearts. And it's a family that we'll always continue to love and be with wherever we are, no matter what. Thank you.
Amen. Thank God for the opportunity to know the Williams family. to love on them. And I want, amen. Young people, won't you just say something from your heart? Hold that mic right up close to
me. I just wanted to say thank you for everybody who's helped me along the way. I mean, I was young when I started here, and you guys led me, like, for a long time, and it's good to have people supporting you.
A couple months ago, I was late to school, and one of you guys picked me up and took me to school, and that just showed that you cared for me and supported me through everything. When I dance, I dance for you and also for the Lord, and I'm just so thankful to have the opportunity to meet everyone here.
I do want to say one more thing, is that we, about 3 or 4 years ago, we went to Azusa Pacific. He actually applied for a position there, and we got the letter saying, you know, thank you, but no thank you. And when he got back, Pastor, within a few weeks, called him and said, I wanted to meet with you. At that time, that's when he presented Peyton with, you know, the with Upward at the time, and that ministry. And when he came home from that and was telling me about it, I said, that's God. He said, I'm going to put you in charge of something small here, an athletic program, and you're going to work that. And you're going to, that's going to be your ministry. That's what you're going to pour into. And everything that we poured into that, he poured into us. And 3 or 4 years ago, when we walked that campus, we prayed and we said, you know, Lord, this is the place. And even though he said no right then, it was a not yet. It wasn't a no, it was just not a yet. And here we are to see the favor when he came back from that interview, and he was so excited. And when we listened to the message from the athletic director saying, you're the guy that we were looking for. And just how the doors open and how much favor that he put upon our heart. But it's true that you sow that little seed and you work it and you nourish it. God's gonna show up and gonna grant you so much bigger. So to go from 100 and something kids in the beginning, grow the program into our own program, which was our vision from the beginning as well, and be self-sustainable. It was, okay. And, you know, it's just that God has just really, that we took that little bit of 100, and now you're getting ready to oversee 20,000, you know, kids, and be able to mentor that to them, and the Lord has just really blessed us, and just so excited for the opportunity. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Sister Beth, for always supporting us, supporting our baby's dreams. Thank you all for praying for us. Amen.
Hallelujah. I love this family, and I appreciate their heart and their spirit. And the thing that I love about the God kingdom is that we are together in heart and soul. And we love the Williams family. And so we're going to pray a prayer of blessing over them now. And I'm going to ask for our staff, our elders and deacons and leaders at will that are here to come and stand with Pastor Bev and I. We want to lay hands upon them. Isaiah 55:12 says, you shall be led forth with peace, with joy, and peace. The hills shall sing, and the trees shall clap their hands. And when the blessing of the Lord is upon your life, peace of God, the joy of God comes upon you. There'll be singing and there'll be clapping. Now we're crying a little bit right now, but it's a good cry, because this part of our family that we're sending back to their family in California, there's a need there too. But God opened the door and made a way for them to do that. And I appreciate their heart. Appreciate even their counsel coming to us many times, praying together for God to move. So would you join us in prayer? Would you reach your hand towards this family? Father, in the name of Jesus, as we lay our hands upon the Williams family, we thank you, God, for the tenure, the longevity, the faith walk. Thank you for the journey that we have walked together in. We thank you for the blessing of the Lord that maketh rich and addeth no sorrow. Thank you, God, for sending them forward with faith and sending them forward believing for multitudes to come to know you as a result of their walk with you. We thank you, God, for the seeds planted, and even, God, whatever work was done in Indianapolis, that it will live way beyond even what any one of us could do. But together, we have witnessed the supernatural power of God when like-minded people come together in faith. And I pray that the Spirit of God would go up on them, be with them coming and going. As they go back to California, let the Spirit of God go with them there. Plant them in a full gospel Bible-believing church where they can also be involved and get plugged into that community. We ask, God, that your Spirit be upon Peyton as he takes on this new role and position, that you have prepared him for such a time as this. Lord, I thank you, God, for wisdom and favor. Thank you, God, for knowledge and increase. I thank you, God, for Kim and her heart and passion as she has labored in the city of Indianapolis, pouring in to students and young people. That, God, that you give her a platform everywhere she's going, everywhere she speaks, everywhere she represents you, that your power will manifest in her life. I pray for Sydney, that she will dance in the presence of kings. I pray that she will flourish in a renowned way, and that the gift that you planted and imputed into her would be so seasoned and flavorful that, God, you will look over the balcony of heaven and smile and be well pleased. I pray for Brie and, God, her gifts and talents and her skills, not only in softball, basketball, and all the things that, God, we've watched her develop into such a graceful young lady. We ask, God, that your Spirit be with her and bless her coming in and going out and cause increase to come into her. I pray for Sydney and for Brianna and for Peyton Jr., God, to not only be able to be planted in this the community that they live in, but, God, give them accelerated friendships that are of the God kind. Knit them with some people who will look out for them. And friends, God, that they'll be able to make quickly because your favor will be upon them. I pray for little Pepe, our wonderful, wonderful young man that you've blessed us with many years. Thank you, God, that he even has the talent to do the splits. God, he has such strength in him and such desire and joy. God, I thank you for his heart, his joyful smile. And I'm asking you, God, raise him up, a man of power, a man of God, with an anointing upon his life. Lord, that the seed of heaven be upon him, in him, and blossom out of him. Pray for the entire family, the grandparents, the parents. God, you know the need. And I'm asking you, God, to send them full with joy. Let there be joy unspeakable and full of glory. And as a congregation, we will stand and clap and sing and pray and believe God for your blessing in the season you have given us, this family. We send them forth with blessing. In the name of Jesus, let everybody say amen and amen and amen and amen and amen. Oh, hallelujah. God is good. Don't you love the Lord? I'm going to ask the Williams family if they would just to come down here to the front. They'll need a box of tissue. And I want you to come by and just hug their neck. Give them the biggest hug and give them the biggest handshake with cash that you're able to do. Would you do that and just bless this family? Just love on them like you know how. Everybody just love on them. Would you do that? Bless them and encourage them. And as they're hugging up here, but we're going to dismiss you in a minute. When they come down, and we want to ask you to just come up and shake their hand and love on them. Send them forward with a word of an encouragement or something from your heart. Would you do that? Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the service that we've had tonight. Thank you, God, for giving us the privilege and the honor of worshiping together. Bless our children. our teenagers, moms and dads, all the ministries of this house, bring us back tomorrow night for food pantry outreach, basketball games Friday and Saturday, church on Sunday. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, the glory, and everyone say amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great evening. Be safe on your ride home.